Alright guys, this is the second video. The previous video we looked at how to set up and install Visual NASM. And this video will show you the first Hello World application written in assembly. We will write the application in 32-bit assembler using Microsoft Macro Assembler. And I'll pick up where we left off. So what you're looking at is the IDE layout that we had tested from the previous video. And so, and I'll show you some little tricks, not tricks, but some things that may not be obvious on what you can do in the IDE, simply because I just didn't have time to document it yet. So I figured a video would be quicker to do this and just show you. So there's multiple ways you can start an application, and depending what you want to create. So the first one, the obvious one, is on an empty canvas like this. As it says here, go to File and then New. So I click the File menu and then New. And you have several types of applications you can create. For 32-bit applications, you must have the 32-bit version of Macro Assembler available. NASM 32-bit has it included. For the 60-bit version or 64-bit applications, you will need the Microsoft Windows SDK for at least Windows 7, I believe. And I showed you in a previous video how to install this one. If you want to develop 16-bit applications, you can. Either 16-bit Windows applications, which I'll doubt you will do, or even 16-bit DOS applications. The reason why I put these in here, you can still do this, is simply a lot of documentation, all the books available. They are actually talking about 16-bit assembly, including 16-bit COM files or 16-bit executables, and also 60-bit Windows are actually, these are kind of rare. If you find information online, it's most likely in older printed books, out of print books. But still, the reason why I put them in here, because the 32-bit assembler still supports creating 16-bit applications to a degree. And for example, you need a 16-bit linker to create the 16-bit Windows applications, if I remember correctly. So let's go ahead and create a 32-bit message box application right up here. So this is one way you can do this. If you right click on the project manager here on the empty project group, I can see add new project. So either that, if I click add new project, you'll be presented with the types of applications you can create. So, because you have this presentation in icons, you can do the same thing from File, New, and 32-bit message box application. I'll do that. So, what Visual NASM creates for you, I'm going to put this down a little bit. It's simply a skeleton. You can think of it as a skeleton layout of your initial assembly code. On the upper right corner, you'll see the initial win32app.exe project name. And then you'll see in the level below the assembly file, which is here. I can switch back to my previous document. We'll come back here. You can also click here on the right, this little arrow here. You'll see lots of files open the more you add to the application. You will also see the build order and what that means. I'll show you later. And the size in bytes. Since we haven't assembled the application yet, it's still 0 bytes. Nothing happens yet to it. This is the actual assembled size of the file that you would see. Or if you link the final executable, you will see the final executable file size. Okay, so without going too much into detail, if you noticed, if I hover my mouse cursor around here, if I hover over 386 directive, if you look on the right side, it will tell you what the directive is about. It gives you some help and some cross references, and where I can, I put in examples. But keep in mind, this is very incomplete, the help. This takes a lot of time to finish up, and if somebody would help, that would be awesome. But if not, I'll finish this sometime in the future. So I basically did just a few just to test the help itself actually. Like if I hover over the model here, if you without having to click it, you can read the model directive and all the information about it. Options, include, directives, I think I did include library, data section, and the code section, and invoke, yeah. Also basic things that you can read about. Another way to get help in general, if you're starting out, click on the help menu. And then you can either go online. The more videos I finish, the more I'll put them in here. I'll probably put them in here. So when I finish this video and finish encoding it, I'll include it into the next version of Visual Masm, so you can actually launch the video like this one inside Visual Masm. This will actually just display my YouTube video in this case, if you click play. So I'll probably add them in here. But in the meantime, what I highly recommend is I have included the Masm 64-bit programmer's guide. If you click this, it will launch your default browser for this, for the PDF to view. It's, let me make this a little bigger here. This is actually very good documentation about Masm itself from Microsoft. If I go up, the programmer's guide for version 6.1. Latest one, if I remember, is version 14 that ships with Visual Studio. 14 or 15, I don't remember now. So in any case, if you read through this guide, it's extremely helpful. Even if you're a veteran, if you're an expert in assembly programming, I still like it. It's still great to read through and remind you some things that really are specific to Masm and the very, very powerful features it has. So go read through it. You'll spend quite a bit of time learning. If you just read through this one, it won't tell you all the ins and outs about assembly programming, but it gets to know a lot of cool features of Masm itself and helps you to develop your assembly knowledge. The reference is the same. If I click here, it's the reference to the individual applications, like the ml.exe, the link, the import library to help make some of the older executables that came with Masm. You can read about the command line switches. Not as interesting, but so this is where Visual Masm will hide this information from you, because it will assist in creating these command line switches for you, which doesn't mean you cannot modify them. You can still fully supply the command line switches if you want to, and Visual Masm will take a step back, and you can have full control over the switches that you send to the assembler. But by default, if I just run this application now, there's a couple ways of doing this. If you notice, there's a project window up here. I can then either assemble the project only or build it, which means building means it will assemble and then link the necessary files together to create the final output, in this case an executable, 32-bit Windows executable. If I want to run the application right away, I could. If I just press F9, it will create a release version without any debug information, or shift or control shift F9 will create the same executable but with debug symbols included. This is necessary for debugging later on. Or you can right click here on the project in the project manager, do the same thing. You can run it right there or press F9. So if I just click this, so the first time a new project has not been saved, it will prompt you where do you want to save it. And remember what I said earlier in the previous video, that there's a root folder for all your projects that will place those applications in there. In this case, the default one is Win32 app, since I haven't renamed my project up here, Win32 app here. So it creates this folder under the root of projects, and then my project name, Visual Masm Project VMP file, which is a JSON file which you can inspect with any text editor also, or with Visual Masm itself. So I'm going to accept the default, say save. Next thing, it's going to prompt you to save your assembly file in an .asm extension. Same folder as the project is saved in. Say save. And here it is. Basically, what happened is it saved all the files, and then it let me close this. Saved the files. It assembled all the files in a project and then linked the files in a project to the final output, depending on the type of project. If I go up, if I make this a little bigger here, you can see what happened. So first thing is it assembles the project. In this case, I only had one in here, which is the assembly one, assembler file. And then it puts the output of the assembled object into the release folder. Oh, there's a little bug here. I have to fix this. It actually did it. It's just not showing you the initial. It should have been assembly1.obj. That's interesting. Yep, work in progress. So I'll fix that. But anyways, it created the final output because it created, during the linking process, it created the executable, which is right here. And then it launched it and executed it. Right, so if you can actually inspect this by right-clicking on the project and say Show in Explorer. It goes right into the folder of your project. Double click here, and this is where the object file is, but it created one, and let me delete this. If I run this, see, it worked outside of Visual Masm. It's about 3K in size. Interesting. I'm going to have to fix this, so it's kind of annoying. I'm going to keep recording this because I'm already on the roll here. But the output window here will tell you what happens. So there's a couple other things. So if I right click here, I can just assemble a project. And if you can see, it just says assembling. There's only one file in it. And see how it worked here, see. But it doesn't do anything. It's just assembling it. That's helpful when you make code changes and you just want to assemble. So sometimes what I do is I do just Control F9. Like in this case, so Control F9. And it assembles and it builds just fine. If there would have been any errors, say something is misspelled, like this, and I press Control F9, see, you will see there is an error here doing the linking. Let's see, invoked. And even the assembly, right? The assembling part should also fail. There you go. Let's fix this. And do it again, right? So that worked. All right, what else can I show you? So I right click on the project. You can do copy path in case you want to know. Like in this case, it'll show you where the file is located here on the path. If you want to get that path and explore in Windows Explorer, copy that. Or you can do a DOS prompt here. And I'm right in my project folder. And go to the release folder, Win32 app, and execute it manually like this. That'll work also. It's about 2.4K in size. Cool. Let's see what else. Of course, you can add additional, as you grow your project, you want to add additional files if you have them available. I'll show you another video how you can use Masm 32 example projects or example projects that comes with the package, how to use them in Masm. Maybe I'll also show Kip Irvine's projects, because Kip's projects, they are a little different, or quite a bit different actually, in some areas than Masm 32 type of assembly applications. And then maybe I'll show Axilion's, I don't know if I pronounce it correctly, Axilion's, his famous tutorials that are online on how to get them into Visual Masm and how to execute them. I'll probably do that in a different video. So here you so right click and you can add existing files or create a brand new file. I can say create a text file, add it to the project, or I can create a batch file. So there is syntax highlighting in batch files as well in Visual Mausum. So this is a comment, copy. As you can see, I have syntax highlighting working. So that's nice. Of course, if I add another assembly file, I can just press Control N because you'll do that probably many times and then it just adds it right away. These templates, by the way, they're shipped with Visual Mausum. You create your own template. So every time you create a new assembly file, it's under the templates folder. Just simply modify the template and it will use that as a stub to fill in your initial assembly code. You don't have to do that, but it's there. You can modify them. So I delete that. Don't want this one. And don't want this one, man. There. Back to normal. Let's run it. F9. And it works. Still works. Cool. Alright, so now I want to show you a little bit things like that might not be obvious. So say this is about font size 10 or 8, I would say. I don't remember now. I think it's 10. But let's say you want a bigger font size. Like in the evening, you get tired. Press Control and then wheel up. Just like Visual Studio, you can actually now increase the font size quite nicely. Or press Control and wheel down. It will minimize the font size. Make it really small or large, depending how you want it. You can also do the same thing in Edit menu, then increase font size with the shortcuts like Control Shift equals and Control Shift minus, like this, plus or minus, get the same effect. So that's kind of cool. I really like this from Visual Studio, so I figured, you know, I want the same thing. It's kind of helpful sometimes when code is so tiny in the evening and you can't, you know, read well anymore. So that's kind of cool. There's some things like you can do, for example, say you want to, like here, for example, string title. I want to see where it's used in the application. Just double click this and it will go through your source file and show you where that's located. You can also press F2. Say I want string message. Where is it showing my code? Like that. It's kind of helpful sometimes. I mean, you have lots and lots of code and some variables, local variables or global variables that you want to locate without pressing Control F and then search for them. You can just highlight them instead. The other thing I want to show you, which is helpful for, especially for beginners, even for advanced assembly programmers, sometimes, you know, there's over 30,000 APIs available now with Windows 10. I think it's much more even now. So it's not kind of nice to have code complete and code lookup available. So if I put my cursor over an API, say like message box, press Control and Shift, it will show you what's available in APIs for that word. Say I want to create, if I tab out invoke like this mess, press Control Shift and here's my message box, right? And now, what if I want code complete? Right now, the way this works, make sure you're on that function that you want to call or API, and then hold on Control Shift and space, which will give you a tooltip on what kind of parameters are available for this particular API call. So there is tooltip available. Same thing up here. If I do this on existing ones, Control Shift and spacebar. And it will highlight, it will mark the parameter in bold for you. So I think that's very common nowadays in IDE, so that's available also. Just wanted to show you this. I don't have the functions that you create available in a code tooltip. I'll put that in at a later point. But watch what happens if on the lower right here, I have two windows, one for labels and one for functions. As you can see, Visual Masm detected in the background, it continuously is detecting and analyzing your code, how many labels you have and how many functions are available project-wide. So in this case, I have this label here, right? So let's say I want, don't know how to say, I'm going to go up here with my code, but I want to jump to it. Either right-click on the label and then go to the label, or double-click it, and it will jump right into your label. This is really helpful if your lines are hundreds of lines or even thousands of lines of code in one assembly file. You don't want to probably have these large ones. You want to modularize them and split them apart. There's different ways of doing this. I'll show this in another video. But this is really helpful. So I want to create, say I want to create a new function down here. Or procedure, rather. So I'll say test procedure. Procedure. And ended. If you notice, you know, I didn't even show you right now, but as I'm typing this, it detected I had the function here. And if I double click this, it will jump to the beginning of the procedure, or right click and then go to function, same behavior. At some point, I'll probably have a project-wide list of functions, which is actually is already built in inside of Visual Masm. It's just not exposed yet, where the entire project, especially when you have dozens of files in your project, and you want to see a project-wide functional list, this is helpful for exporting functions in DLLs, for example. So, cool. So let me just, if I delete this, watch what happens to the functions here, functional list. And it's gone now. Cool. So that's that. Okay, so we can also build it, build only, of course. Now, keep in mind now we have a project here, our first Hello World Windows 32-bit application working. What if I want to create a console app? So I can add another one, add new project, but this time I'm going to use the group to add it here. 32-bit Windows console application, say okay, done. If you noticed, remember what I said, maybe you may have not noticed that there's a build order, which might be important because sometimes you build projects in a certain order that are required by other projects. So the order, or the build order rather, is important when you make changes, and then especially doing the dependencies that they are required first needs to be built properly. And as you can see, the console app now is built second, or as a second project in an entire group. So I can actually, just the way it is, if you notice the highlighted project name means is that's the default project, and that's what actions will be taken on. So if I press F9 just to execute this, of course, first thing it will prompt me. Remember, it will put it under the root folder of your projects, in this case Win32Con for Win32-bit console application. Save it. It will add the assembly file initially to it and then execute it. Because it executed so fast, you couldn't see this really. So the best way to do console applications is just to go to the command prompt. So I'm going to do a DOS command prompt here. And here's my folder that it created for me. I'm going to go to the release subdirectory or subfolder, like so. And you can see there it is. So I'm going to copy the name. And now I execute it. Since I'm in the command prompt, you can see what happens in the console. It will stay like that. So Hello World is printed using the standard IO. In this case, the command prompt IO. And it worked. So let me exit this. So this is kind of cool, right? So now I have two different projects, a regular Windows message box app and a console app. Cool. Now, I can now operate on the entire group itself. I can right-click on the group. I can add a new project again. I can add an existing project or assemble all projects all together. So if I run this, and remember, it will build it in the order that is right now specified. In this case, first the Win32 app. Let's double check if that's true. Let's see. Ha. Okay, so what did I say? Did I say assemble all projects? I'm not sure if it keeps the order. It doesn't look like you keep the order by assembling. Might be a bug. Another one to check. Anyway, so say I want build all projects. Let me see if it keeps the order. Let's see. Win32. Oh, yeah, it does keep the order by building it. Huh, interesting. It doesn't keep the order assembling. It should keep the order even doing assemble process. Yeah, it should do that. I'll check on that. Anyway, so we can build. It does keep the order, the build order. Maybe it's just the build order. Okay, never mind. So it's just the build order itself, not the assemble build or the assemble order. Because the building means it's linking the necessary files together into the final output. So it makes sense. It's just doing the building itself, the linking, when the order is really important. When you build individual projects, which means, I mean, when you assemble the individual projects, you should be okay. All right, so that worked. So what else? I can build all projects. I can assemble all projects. I can show the group in Explorer like before. Same operations, copy, a path, a DOS prompt. You can rename the project group itself, save it as a different file name. You can create a new group and now change the build order. If I click here, alright, so if you for some reason want to change the build order, you can just drag and drop it like so. You see how I change it? Now the console will be built first and then the second one. If I close this OK button, you should see the numbers change. So the console will be marked 1 and the assembly application, the message box will be number 2. Yep, and it did that, see? Cool, so I'll save the whole group. Where is my save group? Oh yeah, so another way to save the group, you can also go in the upper left all the way up here. Save all files, that'll work too. Save changes, yes. Since I have a... Oh, I haven't changed the group before. Interesting. Okay, cool, now it's done. Let me make this smaller again. Cool, so now you've learned the group concept. You can add more and more applications here. I'll create another one. Let's say let's create a new project, 32-bit Windows DLL. Oh, let's create a library first, like so. So libraries are, you know what, I'm gonna show all these other details in another video, because my goal was to show you the first Hello World application, which we've done. I do want to show some more things about the first application, like right click on your project and click options. I think this would be important to know. First thing you know is that it will tell you the project type. In this case, it's a message box application. This just tells Visual Maven what type it is internally in the JSON file for the project. If you open up Win32 app, that VMP, you will have this information inside. And then it shows you the project folder itself, the library path for the project that you can specify here specifically for it, for this particular project, files to assemble. You might want to add files here just for having it inside the project to be managed, but not assemble it or be part of the linking process, which you can do this here. You can add files, right click and then add file, and then just uncheck this and it will not modify or assemble anything in that project. You can now also, of course, since the beginning really, you can have pre-assemble command line switches that you can supply. You can take over the entire assemble process by supplying all the commands you want by hand for the project. So Visual Maven steps back and you take full control over, as long as you know all the switches that you need to supply for all your project files. That's cool. Anything you want to execute after the assemble process, you can put in here, like a batch file or an executable file. Really helpful. Pre-link is doing the, before it executes the linking process or the build process, you can specify commands here, batch files, executable files that you want to execute, it will do that. Exclusive linking, which means you take over the linking process, just similar to the assembly process. You need to know all the necessary switches and command line options. Now here you can add additional switches to the linking process that you want to supply with the switches that VisualMASM passes to the linker. Additional files that you want to link into your assembly projects, you can specify here with the full path all the way to the file. This could be a library file, an object file, or some other files that you want to include. You can do that here. But remember, if there's library file types already supported in VisualMASM, you can do that here automatically. Post-link, anything you want to execute after linking is done. This is like the last step before it executes the file. So you can do that. So that's all the project options you can supply. I think that's good for the for this particular video. So I think we're good for the first Hello World application. We've done that here. I think we're good. So I'll show you in the next video some more of the type of projects what we have available. So when we add a new different project, the different types itself, I'll go into a little more detail on the options, especially for DLLs and the library files and the DOS files. I'll show you all the different file types in the next video. Hope you liked it, and see you next time. Cheers.